From Screen Junkie Studios in the heart of Los Angeles, this is Screen Junkies Movie Fights. Now your host, Andy Signor.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to a special episode of Movie Fights. I'm so excited to be here. I'm your judge, Andy Signor. Next to me are three amazing fighters that are going to tackle Civil War-themed topics that you guys have been demanding on Twitter and all over across the internet, and I'm very excited to do it. Let's get straight to who's here today. First up, the man himself. This is his third time back.
He said
he was coming back. He lived up to his promise. Mr. Kevin Smith!
Folks, happy to be here. More of a lover than a fighter, but in this arena, I will show off my muscles.
Yoga Hosers coming out. I'm excited.
No plugs. Just here to fight.
I'm plugging.
Just
want to
fight. No plugs.
All right.
Although you can go to the Kevin Smith YouTube channel.
Yes, I was going to say, go to his YouTube channel. I'm going to plug it at the end. Guys, he's here again. He's doing this because he likes to be here.
I do.
So if you like this and want him to come back, let's support him. Go to his YouTube channel. It's in our description as well if you click the links.
Even if you don't want me to come
YouTube.com/Kevin Smith. But he breaks news. We almost broke some news, but you beat me to it. Next to him, Mr. Zach Stentz, screenwriter. Let me hype this up. Screenwriter, Thor, X-Men First Class, and Kevin's and you're amazing at Flash episode you guys did this week. Zach Stentz, welcome to the show.
It is delightful to be here. I feel like Pee Wee Herman between Ronda Rousey and Evander Holyfield. I'm going to try and hold my own, though.
Well, you were the first, I would say, you gave Honest Trailers a big boost for us because you came and had the guts to sit and watch the Thor Honest Trailer with us. And funny story, I think it started because you said you hated us.
Exactly, because I thought you guys were someone else. Happens to me a lot.
Is that true? You came in because you were like, I can't wait to give it to these people. And you were like, these are not the people I want to give it to.
Exactly. Pretty much. Well, pretty much.
But we reached out. We're like, sorry, we love your movie. Sorry we weren't. And he's like, oh, well, you guys are nice people. And then we ended up talking. And he came on. And we had a lovely time. And I'm glad we've been able to do this.
He's friendly, dude. I just made friends with him fairly recently, too. And we went down this like path together on this Flash episode where, like, honestly, we exchanged emails about it yesterday. He wrote, I don't know, he goes, TBH, I don't think I've ever received more positive notices in my life. And I was like, TBH, me neither. Like, not even in the beginning when they were like, there's hope before everything went downhill. It's like the thing that I've gotten the most, like, hosannas for. And it's still going on 3 days after the episode aired. So, like, you know.
And I hear you guys are going to do more together. Maybe.
Yeah. Looking, the signs, where's the magic eight ball? Signs point to...
I love it.
Possibly.
Do you see that? He goes, possible. I was meeting like, yes. And he's like, we'll see. We'll see. I'm working on
it. But I heard
some
other news broke that you can confirm here on the show.
Oh. That is indeed true. Am I supposed to say it?
Yes.
I am jumping into the DC universe with both feet. At least until they fire me, I'm going to be writing Booster Gold.
Yes!
For the big screen.
Wow. Very cool.
Isn't that awesome?
For all of my Flash friends.
I love it. That's so exciting. So
yeah,
you're joining the DC world.
Very
exciting. I'm sure you're not allowed to tell us more than that, but I hope when you are allowed, come bring
Jeff
the
Katz
scoop.
Involved? I'm sorry, who?
Oh, Jeff Katz. I know he wrote some issues of Booster Gold for DC.
Not right now, but it's very early.
Cool.
Let me tell you right now, if Hal's going to continue to name drop, I ain't playing this game.
He knows. He's dropping some comic knowledge. Well, Zach, congrats. I'm excited to see where this goes.
Oh, me too.
Exciting. Yeah. Before I don't want to leave him there in the lurch. Mr. Hal Rudnick, you know him. You love him.
Thank you.
Screen Junkies, OG.
Let me just say, it is an honor to be in the Nerd Octagon with these two esteemed gentlemen.
I'm
a huge fan of both. But let me also say, I came here to chew ass and kick bubble gum.
Oh, man.
You messed that up.
And you're all out of ass.
He didn't mess that up at all. That was tremendously
on the fact-checking
erotically
cam,
charged.
Keeping
you.
Us honest, Mr. Joe Starr.
Joe.
Hey,
day.
Guys. I'm so excited to be checking the facts of three men that intimidate me completely.
Which three?
Let's keep it a mystery. One of them's not Hal. Twitter's already blowing up about that Flash episode, guys, so you are continuing to get hosannas today. And I am chilling on the couch
here.
My first fan couch, too. This
yes,
is really
this
cool.
Is, I'm so excited to have Sarah. Sarah Tolley is here. Welcome, Sarah.
Hey, Sarah!
Sarah has always stood out to me because she has these amazing dresses that she sews herself.
That is an awesome dress.
That's awesome. Yeah.
That's tremendous.
It's really fantastic. Sarah, are you excited to be here?
I am so excited. Best early birthday thing ever.
Awesome. Well, now
you pointed out somewhere before the show it happened, somebody was like, ma'am, we're doing Civil War today. Did you dress appropriately? And give her a shot. Give her a shot.
What did you say?
What did you say? Tell them what you said.
I said Batman Forever.
Yes, bitch.
So Val Kilmer's your favorite?
Except not the Schumacher movie.
I thought that's what we were talking about. Oh, shit. I was like, finally, a kindred spirit.
Get out of here. No, Sarah, thank you. You might be helping me today. I'm going to come to you near the end, especially. So pay attention to the arguments. All of you at home, please pay attention to the arguments. If you're watching with us live on Screen Junkies Plus, hashtag Movie Fights Live, we'll be checking in with you and we'll be doing polls throughout the show. Guys, shall we do this? We're about to do all Civil War themed topics. We're gonna break this movie down. Spoilers, potentially. You've had chances to see it, so if you haven't seen
it,
sorry.
I'm ready. I've studied all my Civil War history books from high school, so I'm ready for today's movie fights. I watched Glory. I've watched North versus South, the old miniseries.
I'm so bad I don't know which. I'm like, I'm was Gettysburg Civil War?
Gettysburg? Yeah.
which was the one with Riker?
That was
North and South,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Yeah, Riker was in that.
So I'm ready to kick all y'all's
all right, asses. I hope you guys are feeling nervous. Here we go. Let's get into this.
Now let's do this.
This is where we fight.
Fight.
Make you think of MTV.
Always.
Let them always. Fight.
I'll have to send it to you. It's pretty funny. Yeah. All right, round one. Guys, Civil War, we all liked it. I actually tried to find someone who hated it to come on to argue this film. We had trouble. So, we'll have some questions where we ask some criticism of the film, but first out the gate, we gotta go. What was the best moment in Civil War, Captain America Civil War? Now, I'm taking out the airport scene. I think everyone's always just going off on how great that airport scene was.
Yeah.
So it's off the table. Is that fair?
I think that's fair. That's kind of like the way they should retire Citizen Kane as the greatest film ever made. Give everyone else a shot.
Correct.
Just like we all agree it's the best. Take it off.
Yeah, we can all agree, though, the airport scene is the Citizen Kane of scenes in that movie.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Correct.
And within that scene, Giant Man, Ant-Man, spoilers, going giant is the Citizen Kane of Citizen Kane's. Of the Citizen Kane.
I mean, how
hashtag
much
nailed
Empire,
it.
The
nailed
Empire
it.
Strikes Back line was pretty awesome.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, anyway, we're cutting
that's
whole scene.
That's the magnificent Amber
you guys aren't going to go to Gulliver.
Good Orson Welles deep cut.
Empire Strikes Back.
What was the touch of evil? Never mind.
Oh, nice.
We're going too far down the rabbit hole.
Me and Hal are going to make one of those sitcoms where we accidentally room together. We have to paint a line down the room. We're twin brothers. It's like perfect strangers.
Oh, boy.
Well, Travis of Marvel asked that question. Here we go. I'm not calling him by his new Twitter name. Sorry, Travis. You know I love you, but he changed his name. I only call him Travis of Marvel. And he
dude,
wants to know.
Problems at home. Dude.
I know I do.
Play the game.
I do. What's your favorite moment from Captain America Civil War? So we're starting with you, Kevin. Aside from the airport scene, what are you picking?
What did I say?
You said
I texted it to
when
you.
Brooklyn met.
Not on my phone.
When you said.
Oh, yes, here it is. My favorite moment, hands down. Is, of course, leaving the airport scene out of it. Was there's a tiny beat, but it's when Captain America and Spider-Man have a mini showdown. Spider-Man winds up holding a jetway that's falling on him, you know, an airplane jetway. And Captain America says, "You got a lot of heart, kid," or something like that. "Where are you from?" And he goes, "Queens." And Captain America, like, kind of chuckles, smiles. He's like, "Brooklyn." That, I'm an East Coaster. That was so crazy authentic, man. And, you know, it's weird to say in a movie that's full of, like, boof, woo, and a guy gets big and stuff like that. But that's moments like that are what make those movies so damn enjoyable to me. They bring the real and the unexpected. I know some people like to credit Joss Whedon and the Buffyverse for, like, hey, let's mix up pop culture with what's going on and, you know, like in the middle of an action scene. But I think Marvel has kind of escalated it to an art form. And that moment wasn't a pop culture reference. It was about home. It was about a moment that happens so often in the city of New York. And Marvel has always chosen to make their home in the real world. Unlike DC and Metropolis and Gotham, it's a big point of pride that they're happening in New York, man. It's a big point of pride for everyone that used to read comics. And when I read comics as a kid, rarely did they mention New Jersey, but I'm like, that's right. I could see New York from here. So when they brought that was honestly outside of the airport sequence. Like, that lit me up. And at age 45, if you can light me up like that in a movie, because I can get lit at home, but if you light me up like that in a movie, like, that's a time travel, man. That's a drink from the fountain of youth. That'll take me right back to, like, when this shit was religion to me, and, like, I couldn't wait. I couldn't sleep for 2 weeks prior to Empire Strikes Back coming out, because I would dream what the movie was like, and like it would wake me up and stuff like that. So if you can get me back there, particularly now that I know how the sausage is made, you're very, very gifted. And in the middle of that extravaganza, superhero extravaganza, the greatest superhero movie ever filmed, to have such a human moment that ties right into the heart of why so many of us loved Marvel Comics, took place in the real world. You could actually go to Peter Parker's neighborhood and stuff like that. That brought it home for me. I'm like, they've actually done it. They've turned this whole nation into comic book readers, man. Now even people that would never have that moment on the page can have it in the movie theater. I'm done.
All right, you'll be able to come back. Zach, what's your pick? Favorite moment?
My favorite moment is the 5 minutes of Tony and hot Aunt May on the sofa flirting with each other. That made me, I loved that scene. I loved it for two reasons. One, I love those two actors. Yeah. And going back to Only You when they were in that romantic comedy in the 90s together.
Or Chaplin, even. Or that
yeah,
as well.
They're in Chaplin right. together. So third movie together. And they had such amazing chemistry. I loved the take on Aunt May, you know, someone who's your aunt maybe shouldn't be at death's door, maybe should be a little bit younger and more vital. And the other reason I love the scene so much is that I love Tony Stark as a character, and I love how Robert Downey Jr. portrays him. Through a lot of the movie, he's a very morose, angry Tony Stark, and kind of not giving me those kind of pleasure beats that I love from the character. And in that 5 minutes that it's like where he's a charming reprobate again, you know, he's the guy, it's like, oh, there's the guy I fell in love with in Iron Man 1, you know, in the first Iron Man, and then God knows in the Shane Black one as well, you know, being a little bit douchey but lovable all at once. And I that was my favorite part.
Hal, what's your pick?
Well, it's hard to crap on either of those moments. This film, it's a veritable embarrassment of riches when it comes to lovely, wonderful, awesome superhero moments. But my favorite sequence, and one that I feel gets lost in the shuffle, that might even be better than the airport scene, is Cap and Bucky in Bucky's apartment, and then that ensuing chase through the tunnel. That is the most visceral, exciting action sequence in the film. The airport scene, that had the bombast. I mean, you're not going to beat Giant Man for a moment. You're not going to beat Spidey chasing Falcon and Bucky through that hallway there. But as one contained sequence, that tunnel, that not only did it involve the kind of up-close action that the Russo brothers brought in Winter Soldier, but also, boom, Black Panther was introduced in that tunnel there. And you got Falcon in there. So you had great kind of military style action in that hallway. Like going down that staircase was kind of like Raid 2. That was awesome shit. And then that tunnel, woo! When Bucky pulls that dude off that motorcycle, that is like, that was as good as any moment in the movie, because like just it looked perfect.
Well, don't you think you also loved it because it was a character moment in it, embedded in an action movie, in an action movie moment, and the fact that that whole scene is about how much Cap loves Bucky and how far he's going
yeah,
to go for him.
Absolutely,
that's what I love that scene too. But that's what was speaking to me. It's like, I'm here to bring you in, but oh, other people are after you. I'm with you.
That's a great point. And thank you. I'm going to borrow that for my argument. Yeah, it was really.
Hey, you're helping him.
Yeah. You don't understand this game.
I might not understand this.
Dummy. No.
There was real motivation behind that. You know, and even
said Zach.
Said yes. Zach. Not Hal. I'm not giving up.
Oh, that was my next point. That was totally my next point.
Go ahead, Kevin.
What am I, rebutting?
Yes, now we can all talk. You're fighting. Why is your scene better than the other two's?
Here, my scene, these are all fine choices, as Hal said, an embarrassment of riches, but it is a fight, and I want to take them both out. It is expected to see a visceral action sequence in a comic book movie. If you don't, you'd be really disappointed. You know what I'm saying? If, for me, that just goes without saying. Like, we're going to see the big stuff. There was a TED Talk, I think it was, that J.J. Abrams gave years ago where he talked about the moment that you remember from Jaws isn't like the shark jumping on the boat. It's like the kid and his dad doing this, like, as they imitate one another. It's small human moments that make up the cartilage that, like, dial you into that movie. So while I love the big bombast, or, like, and that was a thrilling chase sequence, watching people run fast faster than cars is fantastic. Mm-hmm. But we expect that. If that doesn't happen, and it's only levels of greatness, right? It's like, who does a better job with the action sequence? The Russo brothers have absolutely crushed in their couple outings now with Captain America. But at the end of the day, we know we're going to see an action sequence. So for me, it's more about a small moment that matters. Anybody could pull off an action sequence, but very few people could give something a brain and a heart as well. And when it comes to the 5-minute scene, it was really like two. And if you want to see those two act together, there's a whole movie about that and stuff. I personally, like, I thought you were going to go for Peter and Tony less than Peter and Aunt May, because the Peter and Tony stuff was just the most juice. It was like watching the older brother, little brother function together. Aunt May was just a doorway to that. So I feel, honestly, there's a human moment in there as well. And if you had gone for the Peter and now I'm doing your job, telling him what I should, he should have done. Anyway, there's my fault.
Yeah, I mean, as far as Spider-Man scenes go, I think the scene between Robert Downey Jr. and Spider-Man in the bedroom was the definitive Spider-Man scene
which
in the movie.
Which sounds way hotter than you meant it. When you said it like that, I got turgid. I was like, yeah, that was hot. That didn't happen, though. Thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I thought we were making a four-quadrant movie and not a movie for little adolescent boys.
Good point. That actually
expanded, you know, the scene with Marissa Tomei. Also, got to give props. They are, you know, age appropriate love interest who is still hot as shit.
I would love to see that connection.
Oh my god! Now who's the little boy? You're like, these people are hot, and I want to see him talk.
Like Tony,
pick up the figures and start doing this.
No, it's all in the works. Tony Stark and Pepper Potts, they're no longer
on
together.
The break.
Oh, but wouldn't it have been great if, like, they asked where's Pepper and Tony Stark said, we've had a conscious uncoupling.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, that would have burned.
I would have liked it. But
she would have been sitting somewhere rolling another tear going, they left me out of the movie and they made fun of my divorce. I'm a person, damn it! She'd flip the table.
I mean, I like the choice of Marissa Tomei, but just as far as looking at the scene, other than the airport sequence, that tunnel... and the fight in the apartment, it was just so layered with different kinds of fighting.
I gave you ammunition for your own argument. What did I do?
Don't worry, he's struggling with, like, it's fighty fighterson and fights and a lot of fightings with the fights and the fights.
And it was so well motivated.
Great character moments.
Yes.
All right, let's go back around. Final thoughts, and you got to tell me again why. What you did a good job of it the most, so you can give me anything you want. But for you two, why is yours better than the other two? I want to hear. But go ahead. Final thoughts overall. You start.
Final thoughts. Ultimately, as stated before, you expect to see, since it's a comic book movie, when you think of comic books, there will be spectacle. Spectacle better be there. And it's, you know, how great that spectacle is in the hands of the filmmakers. But what you don't expect from not just a comic book movie, but an action movie in particular, is humanity. And in the moment that I'm talking about, in Queens meets Brooklyn, that's true New York humanity that echoes the very essence of what the Marvel Universe is about, the heart and soul of New York.
Zach, go ahead. Final thoughts.
Are you an East Coaster?
Yes, Philly.
Yes. Wow, it's tough to go up. It's tough to go up against that. But I would repeat that that the scene with Tony and Aunt May is a needed bit of levity and a needed bit of romantic connection in a movie that is otherwise very grim, fighty. And
which Hal loved, so don't shit on that
with
part
those,
of it.
With those, you know, and you need those little, you know, you need those bits of, you need those bits of levity and those bits of romance and things like that to make the, to make the rest of it pop. And I think, the other thing is, it's the one scene in the movie that lets Tony Stark be Tony, this Tony Stark we all love.
Mm. Hal.
The Marvel Universe is doing so well because it has humanity, because it has those funny moments. I would contend that we go for the action, but we also go to them for those very things you're saying are unique. We've come to be used to those things. This is the best action scene. And if you want New York love, you can watch The Avengers. You can watch the MCU on Netflix. It's all there. There's plenty of New York in those things. Hey, I'm from Jersey too. Represent. 201?
I was 201 before it became 908, and then 732. They split the state apart.
Right on. But yeah, I have much love for New York. But as far we go to escape, and that sequence took me away. That is the reason why we go to these movies. And the different kinds of action going up against the soldiers, going up against the other superheroes, the introduction of Black Panther, and that moment of the motorcycle, that to me, that was the most breathtaking, exhilarating action sequence maybe in the history of the MCU.
By the way, they take out a lot of soldiers and security guards in that movie. Like, don't you want like the post-credit sequence to be like all of those dudes in physical therapy, like trying to, you know, like,
with
like
War Machine.
Trying to work out there. Yeah, with War Machine trying to get their knees to work.
Look
again.
What that Wakandan guy did to my arm.
Yeah.
And, all right. Yeah. Time. All right. That's a big hammer. We lost our small hammer.
That's what she said.
Joestar, don't tell me their votes, but tell me how things are going over there and anything you want to clean up.
Not a lot of facts to check. We've got some thoughts on Twitter of people chiming in with their favorite moments. Stefan Stevens says he loves the Bucky midair motorcycle grab. That's getting a lot of votes. And then a lot of people are going with the moment Tony realizes Cap knew about his parents being killed.
Oh, I was going to say that originally. That was an awesome moment.
And just for further research on Pepper Potts, you guys can find all of Gwyneth Paltrow's advice on conscious uncoupling on her website, Goop. Very
it's
helpful.
It's like the first Goop plug she's gotten.
Civil Goop, man.
That's why I'm here. Civil Goop.
Man, it's really came down to humanity versus romance and levity.
It comes down to humanity
versus escape
monsters.
Is what I got. And Hal, I think you would have won, but then Zach undercutted your argument, and then you used it. It just didn't work in your favor as well as it probably could have. If you had given me what he gave me, I think it would have put you over the edge. So sadly, I can't give you credit for those points since he tipped it up for you. But you did give him that help, and so that undercut you a little bit, which happens a lot in the first round, sadly. So between them, I got to give the edge then to Kevin, who fought
strategy hard.
And just out of debating tactics, Kevin got the point.
Oh my God! You know,
because I honestly, you know what else impressed me? It's like I didn't agree with you in your scene until you kept going, and then you sold me on why that scene
and
was important.
You know, Kevin promised to give me his immunity idol, and then totally reneged.
Your Survivor guy?
I gotta be honest with you.
Oh
dude.
Yeah, we gotta watch Survivor.
Take it around Survivor. From an OG junkie feels good. It's like taking down a superhero.
Round two.
Yes.
There we go. I heard the ding. I hope. Question. This comes in from Liar Ames. Civil War has been received, but surely online wants us to get nitpicky here. She wants to know, what was your least favorite part or character or moment of Civil War, Captain America Civil War? So, Zach, this time we start with you. What was the least favorite part for you? Why? What didn't make the film perfect?
It's interesting. I've seen the film twice now. The first time I saw it on my own, and the second time I saw it with my wife, who is much more of a casual Marvel fan. And it really allowed me, and she hadn't seen Winter Soldier, and she hadn't seen Avengers 2. So I liked it better than she did, but I was realizing, like, oh, maybe this is why the film is doing really well, but not quite as well as it could be, because it's so tightly part of this continuity that if you haven't seen every single one of the films, especially those two, especially Winter Soldier and the second Avengers, you're kind of lost for a lot of it. So if I were to nitpick one thing, it would be that the film is too reliant on it's too reliant on the previous films for its emotional heavy lifting, and that it doesn't quite stand on its own as a film experience that you can go into on its own as well as some of the other Marvel films have, like the first or the third Iron Man, or Thor, for example.
Sorry, I had to plug myself somewhere.
Hal, go ahead.
Okay, but so we're asking for a specific thing that...
What part did you like about the... It's fair.
Gotcha.
You can go broader with
your... I'm going to go specific with a scene here that I felt was weird. I felt like it wasn't perfectly done. Vision and Scarlet Witch cooking the paprikash. I thought that was a weird scene. I didn't think the chemistry went off very well, and it made me imagine weird things about those characters. It made me imagine a weird naked purple Vision with his weird purple naked genitals trying to get it on with a magic creature.
Why is that a bad thing?
I don't know.
That's what I went to. I was like, he's the ultimate battery operated boyfriend. As I said, I go
for escape, not for those weird creature on creature couplings.
That is escape for a lot of people.
Yeah, that's escape for some of us.
I don't want to read that fanfic.
I scooped into a sock when I saw that scene. I was like, whoa. Pepper cash.
Yeah, I just felt like it was a little heavy-handed trying... Like, you were talking about a good moment of humanity. Mm-hmm. That felt like it was shoehorned humanity. That's like, okay, let's have this moment where Vision is the babysitter for Scarlet Witch. But it didn't play. I think that scene could have been a lot shorter, done without the forced... the forced humanity. And also, I found Vision a little bit annoying. And I have one question. Why is his cape like a tapestry? I don't know if we have a picture of his cape.
That sounds like something a 14-year-old write in a journal. Why is his cape like a tapestry?
If you look at his cape, it looks like you pulled down a curtain. And that's his cape.
Well, he saw Thor, right?
Don't they all?
He got jealous of Thor.
No, he's got a weird-looking cape.
The cape came from Thor.
Well, it doesn't exist. It's real. It's a special effect, right?
Joe will try and do his best to find out why that's a tapestry.
Yeah. Let's work on this.
Special effect. I don't think it's real.
I don't think it is either. Kevin, what's your least favorite part?
My least favorite part's a part of Civil War, and I don't want... You know, this might lose me the internet because it's controversial. It's the credits, because I didn't want it to end. I wanted it to keep going. I wanted to watch a 5-hour version of this movie. I would have watched 10. You know how they do those Marvel things where if like you go to 12, 26 movies, we'll give you a medal. I wanted it to be this movie.
What, do you catheterize yourself when you go to a movie theater?
Yes, no, that's what you have a popcorn bucket for. You empty it and then you fill it with urine.
Kevin wears astronaut underpants to the movies.
And at home, because who doesn't want to go to space? But
So the film's perfect.
Film is perfection, sir. Perfection. You want me to start poking holes in their arguments yet?
If you're done, go ahead.
The film's perfection. That's the worst part of that movie.
I expect you guys will jump down that if it's perfect. Go ahead.
The weakest part of that movie is the ending, the actual credits. As the credits rolled and it meant it was over, I said, bullshit! I started screaming. And then they were like, shut up, there's an after credit sequence. I said, oh yeah, you're heroes again! And then I watched the two after credit sequences and then screamed bullshit because I wanted it. I wanted more. I know that's unfair. I paid my money and I got my what I deserved, but it's a long-winded way of saying, I never wanted it to end.
I thought it was a great movie. I don't know if it was a perfect movie. Baron Zemo, a lot of things worked out in his plan that a lot of contingencies happened. The fact that Iron Man would follow Captain America there and they'd all be there to watch that videotape and that someone would have a VCR to play a videotape because that is a dying form of technology. Zemo banked on VCRs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, it was the Soviet Union. Weren't they? Was it Siberia where they watched it or somewhere else?
In Soviet Union, we use reel-to-reel.
Okay, beta. There you go.
I'm going to let them
play beta. There were plenty of scenes that were a little bit of snoozers in there. Agent Carter's funeral, I thought that was just thrown in there.
I'm going to leap across this table and pull out your liar's tongue. Dude, that was the very essence of the movie. That is where Captain America learns to take his stand as Agent 13 is like, what she believed in was sometimes you gotta plant yourself like a tree, motherfucker, I'm paraphrasing. And then all of a sudden he was like, I know what I gotta do. Movie don't happen without that funeral scene. Plus, like,
I loved her so much, I'm gonna date her hot niece now.
Well, yeah. That's yeah, that showed how much it mattered. Also, I think Agent Carter's death could have been used as a nice pivot in an old school Captain America. If they wanted to do.
What is he gonna take? He's like, oh God, death to Peggy. Yeah. I'm taking her on. And he takes shield into a graveyard.
It could open up that would be fun too. And fight skeleton soldiers. let's write it up and pitch it.
But, I can't fight that.
fight it. down the line.
But, like, Agent Carter's death was just kind of a throwaway thing. If they wanted to do a Golden Age Marvel story, that would be a nice way to pivot into a Golden Age Marvel story. So I thought that was kind of just thrown in there.
Wait, can you define what you mean by to pivot into her death is a,
oh,
like,
so if they used it, if they took it, if they like wanted
Steve
to use
gets
it.
Mad about something.
Yeah, if they wanted to use it.
Like, that's what the Civil War should have been about.
Oh, no.
Okay. But you're saying like
no,
an exciting incident?
No, if they wanted
incident?
To use it, to put it in another movie and have it really matter, rather, it's just
I understand,
like
but what do you mean
in.
Really matter? Because this is the death of like an 85-year-old woman. I don't know how crucial that's going to be
but
to the modern
Steve
kind of
just showed up. Have Steve at her deathbed. You bring,
he's Captain
have some
America.
More scenes
he's,
with
he's,
Agent Carter.
I mean, we saw that he had just been called in for the big meeting and the accords and stuff. So it seems like he would be by her bedside all the time. But like, you know, plot took him elsewhere.
I'm going to lay down. An even bigger criticism. Mm-hmm. I think Zemo, as good of a character and as good of an actor as Daniel Brühl is,
yeah.
Was completely unnecessary for the movie, structurally speaking. You could
it.
Have done that entire movie, and in a way, he undermines the premise of the movie, because the premise of the movie is an argument over whether the state should regulate, whether the state and society should regulate superheroes or not. That's, you know, Steve and Tony, who, by the way, are kind of on the wrong sides in that argument in a bigger sense, given that Steve is an FDR New Dealer and Tony is a libertarian.
But
so
even
it's kind
even
of
in
weird.
The
so
comics, they were both on those
yeah,
sides, right?
Yeah, because Mark Millar doesn't understand Captain America. That's why he put Captain
yeah,
America on that.
You're
side.
Saying their ideologies flip a
yeah,
little
their
bit.
Ideology, yeah,
yeah
they're,
weird
they have
to me,
the wrong
yeah.
they
yeah.
have the wrong ideologies, but you know. They actually motivated that okay, but the whole thing is you can have them arguing with each other and coming to blows with each other without this third figure in the background manipulating them to fight. You did not need Zemo to get Steve Rogers and Tony Stark fighting with each other.
I know,
so
but once
that,
their fight is over, which is never going
to
end in them like, we hate each other, because as we saw before Zemo springs his third act trap, in the hallway, like, everything was copacetic. He's like, we're at an armistice. Once Tony found out that there was somebody who wasn't the Winter Soldier responsible for all this, he went to Cap to try to be like, okay, we're done. And reasonably, that movie would have ended there without a third act villain.
Let's
to
get
spark
back
it
to
up.
The worst scene in the movie, okay. The romantic comedy between Vision and Scarlet Witch.
I'm ready to take that down. Ready?
Go ahead.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Are you out
Do
of
it.
Your mind?
Yes,
how,
yes,
like,
I am.
All of us who grew up with Vision, the Scarlet Witch, are waiting for her to fuck this robot. It's going to happen, dude. So that's the first step on the way. We saw them meet in the Avengers Age of Ultron movie. Remember at one point he swoops in and saves her in the midst of something. It was a real kind of tender moment. This is the first time we get to see them interact on the way to couplehood. And I actually thought that scene was kind of fun.
Isn't
the dude
a year
in the
old?
Sweater.
Doesn't that make Scarlet Witch kind of a cradle robber?
Yeah.
Heavens yes.
Like, literally.
But again,
like,
there's
he's
no
a toddler.
Age.
Vision is a toddler.
I agree, but you would have to, we'd have to go home and ask our significant others, wives, husbands, whatever. Hey, man, do you know how old your vibrator is? Shouldn't you be not fucking it unless it's 20? Like, you buy something out of the box, you turn it on, you go. Same with Vision. He's only less than a year old, I'm sure, once she's, you know, and it's been how long since Age of Ultron? A couple months, probably?
Yeah, about that.
And they're still not in a relationship yet, so that hasn't happened yet. But I'd say 6 months to a year. Shit, if on day one, if at the credits of Age of Ultron, all of a sudden she was like, can I fuck this thing? I would totally be for it, man.
So Scarlet Witch and Vision do have a history in the comics?
Yeah. Oh, what, are you crazy? Yeah,
I didn't know that.
Vision, Scarlet Witch, miniseries, they're in the couple, in the comics, they're a couple, they're married. They
got
have,
it.
They
okay.
do this.
Did you know that, Hal?
I had heard about that, but I just didn't like the way it was. I didn't
so you
know
didn't
I
buy that it was heading there. Okay.
Yeah.
Final
not
thoughts, Zach? Did you like to add?
No, I already took my shots at the took my shots at the idea that the movie was perfect and without flaws.
Say that though. My thing was I said the worst part was the end. Was the
you did say it was perfect.
I know, but you asked me. That's fine.
I did.
But
follow
I said.
Up.
But the argument here is what is the least favorite part of the movie? And I said the credits.
Okay.
So that's what they have to go after.
Anything,
Your Honor.
Anything else against Hal?
Yeah, I'd say any excuse to get Vision into those like cozy little sweaters that he wears. I think I'm all for. I wish he would go into battle wearing a nice cardigan.
I think that'd be a good look for him.
Hal, final thoughts?
I didn't think the two had chemistry. I thought it was an awkward attempt to give those characters humanity.
He's a robot.
Kevin, I can't abide by a four-hour movie. I just can't. I want to take a break.
Don't you want
pee.
Your money's worth, though? These movies are expensive. $10.
It gave me my money's worth.
My babysitter costs more per hour. My babysitter that we have to hire.
It gave me my money's worth.
You got a 17-year-old. She can take care of herself.
I do not want a longer movie. It was just about right. And Zach, to your point, it's got like over 90% on the tomato meter. Everyone loves it. Everyone's able to keep up with the continuity and follow the world.
It's doing a little less well than the tracking, and I think that's the it's going to make all the money. Don't weep not for Marvel, but I think it's performing under the tracking because it's getting the core, but it's not
getting
under
the tracking doesn't make it a lesser film.
But also, wasn't it also projected to open at, like, Disney was keeping it modest, saying 170, 175. Didn't it wind up doing 182? So that's really not under the tracking.
Yeah, but, I mean, they always
lowball. The Avengers, though, that, of course it would be under the Avengers.
But it's Avengers 2.5.
It's technically Captain America. We got to keep this shit technical. It's not Avengers, man. That's how a bunch of parents
Captain America film where kind of Steve kind of sometimes gets lost in his own movie.
Absolutely. But since it's not branded the Avengers, as a parent, you're not going, oh, there's an Avengers movie. Let's take it. Particularly if you did go
let's
see
ask
Captain
that question.
America
how much
Winter
you think
Soldier.
That, how much
Holy
you think
shit,
that
Your
cost
Honor, the... he's all over me. Can I finish my argument?
Do you think there were discussions at Disney, like, over whether they stuck the Avengers name on it or not?
And no.
Like, how much
not
movie
at
that...
all. I think the brand management of Disney is so pitch perfect at this point. I mean, you'd speak to being there during the Thor period, but I think by this point...
Paramount, then.
They got it down. That's true. And by this point, they got it down to a science, and there's no way on earth. They know what their Avengers franchise is, Age of Ultron. They're building to it. They knew this was a Captain America movie, but they also saw a sweet way where they could be like, all right, where do we go from 2? 2 was amazing. It was like a Grisham movie that just happened to be a comic book movie. It was like 3 days of the Condor with the Condor as the bad guy. It was kind of amazing. So they're like, where do you go from there? I honestly feel like they sat there going, okay, if we do Civil War, that allows us to bring in a bunch of characters and do Avengers 2.5 without calling it that. But it's still technically very much his movie. He may get lost for a little bit, but no more so than in Winter Soldier when they step away from Cap from time to time, which is very seldom. I just rewatched Winter Soldier this morning, not in anticipation of this, but just like, you know, I haven't seen that in a while. And it plays very well. I saw some people online going, you know, you say Civil War is better than... 2. I think 2 is better than 1. And, you know, everybody's entitled
to their
opinion.
We should be so lucky to have
those arguments,
right?
We'll debate
that soon.
Totally, totally. But I do feel, having rewatched 2 again, in terms of a comic book movie, 2 plays very much like a spy thriller, and it's great. I've taken anything away from it.
Save that thought for the next round.
Okay.
This is your last chance. I have a pointed question for you.
Yes.
You did say the film is perfect.
But that was not the argument here. The argument with the question here
your
was...
Your reasoning for having the end credits...
What's the exact question? Just tell me the exact question.
What's the worst... What's the least favorite part or character?
My answer is the credits. That's all you can judge. You can't judge me saying it's perfect. That's an opinion
so
of amongst
the
members.
Just so I understand your
what
argument,
you
because...
Judge, what you can judge
because
is
Because you didn't
credits.
Want it to be end because it was perfect,
I didn't,
is what
that's
I heard.
Not my... That is not... I'm not going
that's
on record, Your Honor. Literally,
transcript.
My answer is the
credits. Slippery little sucker.
I know how to win this game. I texted you the credits for that reason alone.
And then against Zach, neither of you really did poke holes at quickly because I want to make sure I've got everyone's record. Why is the fact that you don't need to know all the movies, how is it untrue? Do you need to know the other movies to enjoy this movie?
Oh, to take that one out?
I mean,
heavens, at the end of the day, we are watching a Marvel franchise film, so you should have to watch all the movies that come before. I mean, and that's how they're training us, so much so they are interconnecting them. That is the point. Part of the fun is that you see them all. So I don't think that's a drawback where it's like, well, I don't understand this if I didn't see Captain America 2. It's like, well, then you better watch Captain America 2.
My girlfriend saw the film, and she's probably seen a third of the Marvel films. She loved it. There were a couple of questions, but she was on board, and like I was talking with her about it for a couple of days after, and she was like, oh, yeah, I still loved it. It's not too inside baseball. It plays. These are the most popular characters in pop culture that we're dealing with.
Except apparently when Vision and the Scarlet Witch
are playing. Yeah. No. No dice.
And
no
last
way, no.
part, why the credits are the worst part? Do you disagree with that?
Oh, totally disagree. Like I said,
the font they used was beautiful. Come on.
Good. I got stats.
The credits were I'll give you another reason why the credits are one of the best parts. We wait with anticipation. Marvel changed the game when it comes to credits. So when the credits come on, these are the only credits that I look forward to for the end credit sequences. Mm. And like they might not have been the best end credit sequences we've ever seen, but these post-credit scenes, that's why I love the credits.
Yeah, I mean, they used a beautiful font, and as someone who is going to stay there for the gaffer and for
and I don't want a 4-hour movie.
80 VFX people or 80,000 VFX people. Yeah, the credits were beautiful, man.
Whoa, I almost broke that thing.
Can I just point out for the record that I have been staying for the credits longer than Marvel's made to stay for the credits? Because when you watch a movie, that's. I'm a filmmaker. You want to give everyone their due.
Yeah. It's like, you just said it's the worst part.
Well, in that movie. Absolutely.
In that movie. All right. This is tough. I just need to look at
the
like,
this what? You didn't like see my name up there?
You need to go into chambers and figure this one out.
We've got some ground to cover on the fact checking couch.
Go ahead.
If there's anything specific you wanted looked at?
No. I mean, what do you got? Just give me a little bit while I'm thinking here.
Okay, sure. Yeah. Kevin, according to vibrators.com, with proper care, you can use a vibrator technically until the motor dies, but with the caveat that you get what you pay for. Hal, yes, Vision and Scarlet Witch are one of the classic Avengers couples. You did not want to see a woman hook up with a robot, but a lot of people do, according to Wikipedia.com. It's called technosexuality.
My wife does it all the time. It's
attraction to humanoid robots, man. People acting like robots or people in robot costumes. Sarah, aren't you glad you're sitting next to me for this one?
Sarah goes, I am glad to sit.
I am turned on.
Nice. Me and Thank you. The same job.
Twitter chimed in. Stylo says that Crossbones was lame. He was kind of a shoehorned in villain.
I could argue that. That
Devin
awesome.
McLaughlin hated the Agent 13 kiss as his theater cracked up laughing when it happened.
What about the tapestry cape?
Tapestry cape. According to Reddit, people are saying it's supposed to be a circuitry pattern.
Gotcha. Yeah. Looks like a
Who
tapestry.
Who won round one on the polls?
Round one was... Let me back
your
up.
Internet? Are you doing it all on your phone?
I'm doing it on my phone, Andy. round one went to Hal.
Oh.
Wow.
That's what the internet
With the
said?
Chase.
For the chase scene is the best part.
Thanks.
All right. We have a poll results for this. You can tell me right after. This one's legitimately tough.
You'll do the right thing, I'm sure.
I mean, you were kind of all picked bad. I mean, just bad. I didn't know it.
You didn't like our answers? We
didn't
like your question.
Because I just feel like you did a cop-out answer. You did.
Hey, I directed cop-out. It makes sense.
Did you
don't make me make that joke.
Andy, can I ask you a side question real quick? Have you ever thought about doing it? How come we haven't done an honest trailer of one of Kevin's films?
Popular enough. Most of the audience would be like, what is this movie?
Not true.
They're like, here's a black and white film from the 90s. Kids, remember that? They're like, I wasn't born. I was come then.
Seminal independent film.
Yeah, we're
that was good. Seminal, though. That was a good joke. Sucking off the two of us. The two of you is a junior Kevin Smith. You ready to go?
I just feel like you picked a little bit of a cop-out answer, and then it came down to you did pick a broader con, and you changed your answer, too, because that wasn't what I was prepared for.
I object to the term broad.
But you stuck there, and then you picked a part that I think they did pick out. It was a preference for you, so I had to go strictly on the arguments then, and I just think, based on the arguments, I heard more reasons from both of you than I did from Kevin of picking the others apart. Sorry.
Right.
Your argument to Zach was that you should watch the movies, but that is a lot of homework to require a person
Bullshit,
to do.
Bullshit! This is a franchise, Judge.
I gotta go, Zach. Zach gets the point.
Oh, give it to him. I like Zach. He wrote that episode.
Yeah. He gets one.
Totally.
He gets one.
Give him a round, for heaven's sakes. We're
right,
a team.
That was a tough round. What did the vote? What did they say online?
They copped out with Kevin. They went with the credits.
There it is. I got the popular vote.
How much?
I'm the Trump of
he
this
knows
game.
How
which is horrible
to
say.
Play into the cheap seats.
Always, son. Always.
Round three comes from the real. Tell me, as my.
By 18%, by the way.
Okay, so pretty good lead there, Kevin. Oh, so I went against the. I went against the people.
Look at that.
So, but you won the people's vote.
Yeah.
Real Cody Hall on Twitter wants to ask this one now. We just started talking about this earlier, so this is fitting. Where does Civil War rank among all the MCU films to date? So now you have to tell me where you're ranking it, and if you're not ranking it at number one, you have to tell me which films are before it, and then we have to argue why that's right. It's Hal, you're starting. Where do you rank Civil War?
I rank it number three behind Winter Soldier and Guardians of the Galaxy. Mm. As far as standalone...
Which one's first?
Oh, Winter Soldier.
And then Guardians,
and then Guardians, and then this film. This film is really masterfully done. There are so many balls in the air. There are so many characters to deal with. But as far as the best films, Winter Soldier set a tone in the Marvel Universe. It introduced something amazing that we hadn't seen before. That kind of realistic, gritty action with the Hydra infiltrating S.H.I.E.L.D. and everything that was going on, and the real life kind of NSA issues that the Russo brothers infused into that film. It was a startling film. Like, that film was a revelation. No one expected what Winter Soldier did. And then Guardians of the Galaxy, it just opened another door that no one expected. It took us on this thrill ride that's one of the greatest unexpected cinematic experiences like I've ever been on. I walked into that theater and was just transported. So those two films, just as far as giving you the best, most exciting movie-going experiences, the best Marvel films, one and two.
Notch above Civil War. Okay, Kevin, what's your pick? Where are you putting on the list?
I say that, for me, it's the best of the Marvel Universe. It goes number one. And I love, the Guardians was one that perhaps I didn't consider too deeply, and I love Guardians, it's very creative, but this is my criteria. What is the exact question, Your Honor?
I love that you're doing this. Where does Captain America Civil War rank among all the MCU films to date?
Definitely number one. This is the culmination of everything they've been doing since Favreau's Iron Man. One could even argue all the way back to the Hulk movie as well. They were building a universe where characters come into and interact with one another. The Avengers is a monumental box office event for that very reason. It's the first time we saw a bunch of suits standing around together and fighting. This takes it to the next level. I mean, more so than even Avengers Age of Ultron, which had a bunch of core characters. This is a movie that has even more characters. Now we've gotten to the point of normalcy, where it is a Captain America movie, it's not an Avengers movie, but still, look at how many other characters you're getting coming in and out of it, including the very strong spine of the Marvel Universe, this guy right here. I remember when this whole thing started, man, they would talk about, like, well, he'll be in the Iron Man movies, he'll be in Avengers a little bit, but nah, he ain't gonna be in the rest of them. Now we're at a place where you can't get Robert Downey Jr. to not be in one of these Marvel movies. He actually shows up. So I love the fact that they've built this universe in such a way that it's now almost commonplace, almost commonplace to see that many heroes together, and this is a comic book movie. So, you know, where are you going to take me? I want to see a lot of comic book characters. The joy of reading a Marvel or DC, any comic book when I was a kid, was not just, hey, there's the one hero character from the title of the book, the titular hero, but instead, you know, I'm sorry, it sounded dirtier than I meant it, but not just your titular hero, for the people that were like turgid when I said that, but also, hey, there's a flyby by a Falcon. Hey, Daredevil swings through because we're nearby Hell's Kitchen. So this really felt like a comic book movie to me, because my lord, it was full of comic book characters, and the plot was comic book perfection. I remember going into this movie going, like, because I'd heard that Zemo never put on the mask, and I'm something of a purist, and I was like, come on, I'll see a dude in a pink ski mask, that'd be amazing. Fact that he wasn't in the mask was so well done, but he functioned like a supervillain functions in the comic books. He had a plan. Most of these Marvel characters don't. His plan was specifically how to disassemble the Avengers over something very personal. So it's not just like, I was created to protect the world and now I just want to stop everybody because I'm a robot. It sounds like that guy from TV. Like, there was a lot more involved in terms of, like, this was a man who lost everything because of these heroes that did something and then flew off. And he had a reason to hate them, and he was from Special Forces, and he saw all the information that was dumped on the internet and de-encrypted it and figured out how to turn them against one another. It was a very smart plan that is so comic book to be like, I can't beat you, but if I can make you beat yourselves, which sounds dirtier than I meant it, like, then that will be the ultimate revenge. So to me, ultimate comic book movie in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Like, this is what they dreamed about back when they were still talking about making Iron Man. Like, could you imagine getting to this place? And we've seen what happens when a company tries to do it all at once in one movie. Like, here, everybody, here's the whole fucking world. These guys slowly built up to it.
What could you be talking about?
I don't know. Just, you know, the Archie universe.
Riverdale's going on TV,
Where are you picking so we can open this up and you can know who you're fighting against? Where do you place it?
Five.
Five.
I say that as someone who loves the Marvel movies. I think five is a perfectly respectable number to be at because the top four are some of my favorite movies of all time.
If Thor's number one, you're dead.
No. Okay. Thor's not even in the top four for me. I disqualify my own movie. My number one is the first Iron Man. I think nothing is ever going to top the experience of seeing that movie in the theater and going, oh my God, Favreau hit the tone that they've been trying for so long, right in the middle of the bullseye, like William Tell, and the perfection of the casting of Robert Downey Jr. And I know you could talk about this third act and that he's just fighting the dude in armor, but it's just a wonderful movie. Second for me is Guardians, largely for the same reasons as Hal gave. Third, Winter Soldier, great movie, largely for the reasons Hal gave. See, I'm saving you time here. Fourth for me is Iron Man 3. Why? It's a little bit of a mess in places. I don't care. It's a Shane Black movie. That's why I love it. There is a certain sameness of tone that is creeping into the Marvel universe a little bit, that you kind of know what you're going to get going in. And I love that they let Shane Black as a writer and a director invest so much and give that third movie so much of his flavor. Everything from the fact that it's set at Christmas. I mean, what a classic Shane Blackism, to the henchmen with the, you know, the fact that all the henchmen have personalities and the one guy runs away rather than be the last one to get killed by Tony. I love that movie for so many reasons. But Civil War is a strong number five. Is a strong number five for me. And I, again, given the quality of those first four movies, there is no shame in that.
All right. So I'm going to focus on here. I'm going to help to cook this up. You have to tell me. We need to know why he's wrong in it being number one, and then you have to help me tell me why his four and his two are not worthy of being on top of Civil War.
So I will say that Iron Man 3, I enjoyed it, and I've got mad respect for Shane Black, but that the way they handled the Mandarin in that film was like a turd in my Cheerios, man. I just was so disappointed by the Mandarin.
I thought that was so clever.
I thought the rug was pulled out from under us.
Superhero movie? Oh, going a place and not you didn't
in a,
expect?
Not in a good way.
Oh, how terrible.
Not in a good way. I thought they turned something that could be a factor, and that's what these movies need. We were just talking about it earlier with Baron.
Oh, I miss my racist stereotype. Where is my racist Fu Manchu stereotype?
That aside, the universe lacks awesome villains. I mean, we've got Loki, and I'm hoping for Thanos, but
you're welcome.
That could have been a great... Yes. Thank you, sir. Yeah. Shake my hand. Yes.
Me and Ash and Don Payne and Tom Hiddleston in 50 years of Marvel continuity.
I played this much role.
You know,
your villain is better than the way they handled the Mandarin in that film. It really hurt the
film.
But
he wasn't the real Guy Pearce was the real villain.
And then Iron Man it's a great film. I feel like we forget how good it is. But I feel
there
like
would
they
be
they
pro- no MCU. There would be no
of course.
MCU. If
so
it,
you
if
you have
Favreau
to
didn't
you have to give major
that.
Respect to that. But they perfected the process as they went forward, and it's not the best of the MCU, as you say.
Kevin?
Which one am I doing?
Whoever you want. Who are you going up against?
Both of them, because obviously my position is that this is the best movie in the Marvel Universe. Number one was Iron Man for you. Is that what you said?
Yes.
So
I said
Iron
Winter
Man,
Soldier.
And you said...
Winter Soldier.
Winter Soldier. So Iron Man...
And then they both had Guardians, so you can just keep all those.
Totally. Iron Man is a wonderful film, fantastic, and you're absolutely right. It's the very solid spine upon which this entire Marvel Universe rests. But just like Star Wars was an amazing movie, Empire Strikes Back got better because they had something to build on. So to me, Iron Man is Star Wars, and Civil War feels like Empire Strikes Back. It doesn't negate, you know, Iron Man by stretch of the imagination, but they were building a universe. Iron Man's one character. And some could argue that, like, in a comic book movie, like, there is really no villain until the third act. He builds a suit throughout the second act. He builds a suit throughout the second act in Civil War. It is nonstop from start to finish. Comic book action and a gripping story, and believe me, I love Iron Man.
Is there a Suicidal Tendencies song in Civil War? No, sorry.
You're absolutely right.
Hello.
Well, we'll lose the Suicidal Tendencies audience, unfortunately, on this one. But
hold on, let me finish.
But the at the end of the day, the notion of Iron Man 3 being higher than Civil War. I enjoy Iron Man 3, and yeah, not only because it's a Shane Black movie, but I love Robert Downey Jr., so I'll watch him read the phone book, as they say. But Iron Man 3 is a movie where he's barely in the suit. The suit barely is at play. Civil War has to go above that by virtue of the and also the Mandarin argument in terms of, like, you know, I want my racist Mandarin. You don't have to do that version of the Mandarin, but you could have done a version of the Mandarin that was close to the comics. Just like, you didn't take Loki and be like, now Loki's this guy took off a mask and it was a dude behind with a video game, and everyone be like, you fucked Loki. After years and years of history, you fucked Loki. You did Loki right. What a lot of people felt about that Mandarin, I was not one of them. I thought it was kind of fun, but I could see the point of view where people being like, what the hell? Because you think of that character as one way. It would be like if suddenly the Joker was played as a very serious person or something like that, like completely conflicting what it
serious.
Is. So, yeah. Guardians, wonderful movie. Almost doesn't even need to be in the Marvel Universe, as we all know. It's kind of tangential at this point, and I would almost make the argument that, you know, shy of the sequence where, you know, you see what's-his-fuck, they give him the jewel at the end and shit.
The one that they accused us of ripping off?
Yes, yes. Aside from that, it's almost really, I mean, again, I don't want people being like, rip his tongue out, but there's so little Marvel Universe in Guardians of the Galaxy that you could almost, they're Marvel characters, but they haven't even interacted with the world at large. They're very in their own pocket, and I love that movie, and I thought he did a great job with it. But in terms of the ranking, Civil War, to me, gives you, like, everything you wanted in terms of, like, here's all the characters we've put together so far, minus the Guardians. All the characters who've ever been on planet Earth, because they haven't been to space yet, the Avengers, that's coming. And then eventually they'll meet the Guardians. So this felt like it. I feel like this was all building to this. Everything else, not saying everything was foreplay, but like everything was like, you know, Iron Man is like that high school boyfriend or girlfriend you had who you were with for like 4 years, and then you went to college and things kind of fell apart and you were like, I thought I knew what love is. Then you fall in love with somebody else and it's deeper. Civil War is like being married. Like, you're like, now I know what love is.
I agree with all of your points, but about the Avengers, not about Civil War. That's when this came together. That's when we had our first nerdgasm over the possibilities, all of the steps that the Marvel Universe, that Thor, that Iron Man, that Captain America, the MCU doing the work, and finally they got to Avengers, and Avengers killed it,
and
knocked
Avengers
it out of the park.
The doorway
and that's
Civil
not
War,
on your list, how come?
It's not on my list because I thought Civil War did Avengers 1 better, but the points he's making, Avengers was that satisfaction, more so than Civil War. And what you're saying about...
For you, Hal.
For me, absolutely. And then Guardians, almost... I mean, the Marvel Universe is varied, and Guardians was so important because we got our biggest taste of Thanos yet. Mm-hmm. And also, my top
Thanos,
two...
Thanos, who hasn't interacted with really anybody in the Earth-based Marvel films.
Yeah.
That's my point. The Marvel Cinematic Universe.
But we need that because what are we leading to? The Infinity Wars. We're leading to the Infinity Wars.
Totally.
So it's hugely important. And my top two of Winter Soldier and Guardians of the Galaxy, those are the two unique tastes in the Marvel Universe. Winter Soldier, distinctly gritty and still a superhero film. And then the wild ride of Guardians of the Galaxy 1 and 2. Those Iron Man films are solid, not the best. Civil War, the reasons you gave better in Avengers.
I disagree. There are more by virtue of the fact that there are more characters in Avengers. If what you're like is like they all came together in Avengers, great. They all came together in Civil War with even more characters, and Black Panther and Ant-Man's involved now. So,
Zach, go ahead. Last thought.
I just say that screenplay. You know, I love the Avengers. Don't get me wrong. It would probably be like number 6 on my list. But like screenplay wise, the Avengers is a little bit of a mess in places, and is coasting a lot on the fact that you're seeing those characters together for the first time, and isn't that cool? If you go back and look at that movie again, there is a whole lot of hanging out in the helicarrier in the second act.
Well, Avengers isn't on my list.
Then what am I arguing?
Your Honor, he's wasting the court's time.
I'm wasting the court's time.
Last thought on why Civil War isn't as good as the ones you said.
because Civil War has a certain familiarity and tone. It's wonderful, but I feel like it's doing very effectively things that I've seen the Marvel Universe do before, whereas Guardians and Iron Man 3, to give two examples, gave me something that I hadn't seen before. One gave me a wonderful, charming space opera with a more hapless hero than we've seen before, and the other one gave me a strong directorial presence and a Shane Black movie in the middle of the Marvel
Universe. Quick response to that? Do you disagree?
When I go to the Marvel movies, I want to see a Marvel film, and I'm happy for anybody to kind of get their POV across and stuff, but I would argue that it's not really, other than Christmas, it's not really a hardcore Shane Black movie. Sidekicks or hired help that crack wise, he may have done it like in the beginning, Lethal Weapon, but that's become kind of a trope, so I don't think it was very specific to that. But also, more importantly, when I go see a Marvel movie, I don't want to see somebody else's flavor. I want to see the flavor that they've put in every one of those flicks, so it's part of a whole.
Oh, sorry. These are good fighters. I'm having some trouble.
That was loud.
Joe, anything to add?
Let's see here. We can do our Rotten Tomatoes rankings from best to, I guess, worst in this case. Leading the pack is Iron Man 1 with 94% on Rotten Tomatoes, then Avengers with 92, Guardians of the Galaxy, Civil War, and then Winter Soldier. So they're actually a lot more in line with Zach, who, by the way, I agree with on Iron Man 3. It should be ranked way higher. 6 is a surprise. It's Ant-Man.
Huh. That's Sarah, you're listening. I want to get Shannon. What do you think based on the arguments? Where are you standing?
Based on the arguments, I go with Hal.
because
I agree, like you said, Avengers kind of did it first before Civil War did it. And that's where it got me on that.
Interesting. Okay. I think. What? Would you like to say something else?
No, not at all.
You're allowed.
No, not at all.
I think you made a good argument about the tone, that seeing things we haven't done before. Clearly we haven't, but you made a very good argument about when I come to see a Marvel movie, I want to see them together, and why Civil War sort of did that. You, though, also, Hal, did give a very strong argument because you said Winter Soldier set us these tones and opened these new doors, and without us adding as many as Zach did. Based on these arguments, I think I got to go... with Kevin, only in just that his argument was pretty strong in the fact that when I want to go see the Marvel movie, that's what it is, and this is the better version of those films.
I just threw that out at the last minute, too!
That was the last thing that sort of stuck with me, and then Iron Man 3, whether it was good or not, I think
think he was right, but, you know.
You were close.
I couldn't argue the same thing.
It went slowly to Kevin, so, but very close for Hal. Iron Man 3 put you out. So it really was between you two.
I will wave the flag for Iron Man 3
but I knew he'd lose popular vote on the internet because everyone hated the Mandarin.
You just didn't give me a concise reason like he did. It was very close. So sorry, Hal, but very close.
But we're elite.
All right, going into round 4. We're now at 1 to Zach, 2 to Kevin. It's still anybody's game if Hal can pull these through. Round 4 comes from Rodri Jones 7.
What a great name.
Which is Gazabel, who asks us to pick a character from Civil War and pitch us their next ultimate solo. So just tell me your character, who you're picking, and then give us a little bit of what you think that movie should be, and that'll be what we do. Kevin, you're up first. Do you remember who you picked?
I do. mine is called, and this is the pitch movie?
Yes.
Mine is called Web of the Black Widow. Number one, this character's so insanely strong. Why she hasn't had her own movie by now is beyond me. In a world where, like, Captain America can shoulder his own film, 2, 3 at this point, one being an origin, the other two being completely different from the origin story, why couldn't you do that? Look at that. That's an origin picture of Black Widow. Remember when her hair looked that silly back in Iron Man 2?
And she still looked that great.
She's come so far since then. This character's so much more interesting than she was in Iron Man 2, and I liked her in Iron Man 2.
She can do a Pantene commercial, too.
Easily. She's had so many looks in the hair. But more importantly, come on, man. Like, you know, and Kevin Feige has said, like, we're committed to making a Black Widow standalone. Easily, that could be a franchise. This, as the actress herself was in that Lucy picture, shouldn't have done business, did huge business, man. So, like, people like ScarJo to begin with. I'm using that Hollywood lingo. Sorry about that. Scarlett Johansson. But more importantly, that character's strong, son. She's like Ben in the Marvel Universe since Iron Man 2, in both Avengers movies and now Captain America's Winter Soldier and Civil War as well. And I don't know how they're going to work her in outer space, but she's going to space for those flicks as well, I assume. She's a flagship member of the Avengers. Give her, her own movie at this point. You know, I understand we all want to see a Hulk standalone movie. That'll be tied up a bit.
Do you team her up with anybody?
I mean, I didn't know I was allowed to. I thought it was standalone.
You can.
What characters would I bring
just
in?
Just like you would bring, they're bringing Iron Man into Spider-Man. Like, you can...
I would bring in Ant-Man, because then it's like you can have bug-on-bug action, where it's like, the bugs are at it, the spider and the ant are going to bring down something and stuff. So, yeah, I go Black Widow.
Does that mean the Black Widow's, like, going to bite off his head after sex?
That'd be amazing. Why do you have to take it dirty all the time, Stents?
biological, man.
That's absolutely right. That's nature. Yeah, but no, I wouldn't do that, but I'm not the writer.
Zach.
I love what I, you know, here I'm gonna throw some praise at Kevin. I love what Kevin is saying.
I think frankly
Black Widow is an obvious choice. She's gonna happen. I would go a little further into the down the card and do a Scarlet Witch movie. One, but you know, for some of the same reasons as he's listed for Black Widow, I think as you see in the Avengers, it's still Marvel is still kind of a big sausage party, and we need more female-led movies. Marvel movies. You've got Elizabeth Olsen, who's a terrific actress, who's never really gotten the chance to really shine in these movies, simply because she hasn't had the screen time. I think she could totally hold the screen in a movie of her own. The other interesting thing that you can do, I know there's the weird thing with the, we can't use some of her backstory because it belongs to Fox and the X-Men. There's all the weird stuff between Fox and Marvel, but you could still go into her backstory as a gypsy or Roma character and do this really awesome story where you talk about you do a thriller that uses the occult side of the occult magical side of the Marvel Universe, which I know we're getting in Doctor Strange, but we've only barely seen a little bit of, and you get to do a movie about what's going on in Europe right now with refugees and the migrant crisis and things like that, and give it a superhero spin, because at their best, the Marvel movies are really great allegories. You know, the way the Iron Man movies are essentially allegories about America's involvement in the Middle East. I think you could do a great story about migrants and refugees and what's happening in Europe now using Scarlet Witch is the entry character.
Do you include anybody else from the universe in supporting characters?
Oh, sure. You don't, you know, I mean that's Kevin and Hal have both pointed out quite eloquently that when you've got the whole cast to play with.
But is there someone you would pick in for your pitch here?
Vision.
You'll win the internet. Got fucking sight vision, dude. Like, trying to help you. I'm like Batman. Is Batman be Superman? Where I'm like, hit him in the fucking throat.
When can't go vision. He said prequel. It's a prequel. This is early. Can't go vision.
Who said prequel?
He said it could go back and forth.
I don't think it has to be a prequel. Yeah, I think you use vision for that. You use vision for that relationship, and you use Steve Rogers as a kind of symbol of American power.
Okay, Hal. Who are you pitching us?
Bring it, Hal.
Exterior. Avengers headquarters. Night.
I didn't know we were allowed to pitch like this.
Alarms are sounding. Everyone to the situation room! There are wars and explosions happening all over. Avengers, assemble. They fly to all points to lock down several situations that are going on across the globe and in the universe. Turns out, these are red herrings. These are false flags.
Die Hard
Avengers headquarters is left undefended, except for one man, War Machine. He was rehabbing. They thought he was out of commission. But as we saw, he's got his legs back under him with the prosthesis that Tony built for him. And it's up to him to defend Avengers headquarters from a coup put on by who? A wronged Thunderbolt Ross. because Captain showed up at the raft. He let all the other Avengers go. Thunderbolt Ross wants to shut him down for good. Sokovia Accords, you don't abide? Oh, I'll show them, William Hurt says.
So is this Die Hard in the Avengers
it's
Tower?
It's Die Hard in the Avengers.
With War Machine, great.
AKA Home Alone at the Avengers. AKA Home Alone 2 with the Avengers.
All right, guys, what do you think? Which one aren't you buying a ticket for?
Well, he had me with the pitch. Presentation is everything.
It helps.
Right away, I'm like, oh my, I'm seeing this movie. Until he revealed the star, until it was like War Machine, I'm like, oh. War Machine. I like War Machine.
Kevin, don't be racist.
That has nothing to do with race.
Don Cheadle.
I love Don Cheadle.
Is the finest actor, finest underused actor in the Marvel Universe. Hotel Rwanda.
Best.
Boogie Nights.
Keep going. You can't list two and stop.
Devil in a Blue Dress.
There you
Thank
go.
You.
There you go. Going deep cuts. Look, I love Don Cheadle. This ain't about race. War Machine is Iron Man 2. You know what I'm saying? If I want to see a movie with Iron Man, let's watch Iron Man. And usually in Iron Man, they're like, hey, there's War Machine. A standalone War Machine movie would be like, well, what are his powers? They're like, same as fucking Iron Man.
Oh, and you know what happens at the end of my movie? Iron Man dies.
Well, he just lost right there, right?
Yeah.
Lost
and
the internet,
War
lost
Machine
you,
takes
lost
the
mind.
Mantle. War Machine takes the mantle. Robert Downey Jr. is not going to want to do it forever.
You're making a bad situation worse, Al. You're digging that hole so much deeper.
Oh, man.
But wait, what was the other, what are we doing on Zach? What were you?
Scarlet Witch.
Scarlet Witch is tougher to argue against because I would like to see a Scarlet Witch movie. But Black Widow first. She's been there longer, man. And, like, we know that character so much more. So who's also on a purely business level, like, someone has to greenlight these movies. You're looking at Scarlett Johansson versus Elizabeth Olsen. This one's got more audience, man. It's like, doesn't matter what movie they make. It's like more people know who she is. So she's been doing it longer. She's been committed to this Marvel Universe nonsense since Iron Man 2 to suddenly jump Elizabeth Olsen and the Scarlet Witch ahead of her and that character, to me, would seem counterproductive.
I want you to take a minute, just give me a log line. Where are we seeing her? What's your Black Widow movie a little bit, since I got a little bit more of theirs? But let's go to Zach as you're pondering to give you a second.
Yeah, you're like a dude pitching, and it's like, it's Black Widow.
Yeah.
Come
That's
on,
enough,
guys.
Dude. I walk into rooms, I'm like mall rats. Clerks in a mall. And that's how that happened. It did.
I got it. That worked. It worked. And you had a Stan Lee cameo before these
yeah,
guys.
That's
true.
Excelsior, my friend. Excelsior.
I had my own universe before, but they had a universe before me from the comic book, so technically yeah. they win. Go ahead.
I have the... to mine... it would feel a little bit like Rogue One is to the Star Wars universe. It's an extension.
What movie?
Are you defending your
Are
own
you
or attacking
talking about
his?
Yours?
Yeah, I'm talking about mine.
Would you stop
I'm talking
with the War
about
movie?
Die Hard at the Avengers.
Isn't he supposed to take down the other two?
Well, yes, oh. but he's allowed to defend his still because yeah. You did say it was awful.
I didn't say it was awful.
Oh, you said you don't. Who knows?
I
wants
said
to see
it was awful.
Machine.
Interesting.
Mine is better than the both of yours simply because I gave a story and a plot and what would happen in mine, and neither of you did.
Zach, give me a little bit.
Zach said a flashback and flash forward.
Would you like to clarify? You said I heard the European migrant crisis, things like that, and there is a love story.
No, I'd rather attack both of yours. defend my own. No, I love the idea. I love Scarlett Johansson. I love the idea of a Black Widow movie. I loved it even better when it was called Lucy and it was weird in French.
I liked it better when it was called Salt and Angelina Jolie was in it.
Wow.
So
I liked it better when there was no sarcasm going on at this table.
Do you have a pitch ready?
Yeah, I have a pitch. First off, I do want to say for the Scarlet Witch movie, I don't go to a Marvel movie to sit there and be engaged with the migrant crisis. I read that on the news page every morning and stuff. If I go to Escape, I'm not going to be like, all right, I got my popcorn, my big drink, I'm a fat American, take me away. And they're like, look at these hungry people, why won't you help? And then they show Scarlet Witch helping, and then I'm sitting there going, but that doesn't happen in the real world, and then you feel bad. So for that reason alone, maybe we should stay away from the headlines. I feel like my story would be this. Black Widow finds out that the president of the United States is a Skrull and has to assassinate him. And that happens in the first 15 minutes. There you go. People are like, what happens after that? everything, bitch. Everything. I'm not going to go into it now because, you know.
You're saving it.
That
spoiler.
Is so awesome. That is so awesome. And the only problem is that Fox owns the Skrulls.
All right, so we'll call them, we'll call them the Kree Warriors. That's what they call them in the Avengers. So they're the Kree.
And there's one other problem. That's the plot of G.I. Joe when Zartan becomes the president and they have to assassinate
wow.
him.
Did that happen? Yes.
Yeah.
I didn't see that movie.
So what you're saying is that it works.
By yes. the way, they misused Zartan. I don't want to go on a tangent here.
I still stand by it.
All right, I heard enough. Go ahead, we're quick.
No, I'm thinking like Scarlet Witch. We're looking back on her life, and it was a sled all along.
Nice.
All right, now I really called it. Much. Joe.
Oh, back to Citizen Kane.
Yeah, we came back.
Anything to add there, Joe? Did you get internet yet?
We're at full internet capacity. Pretty excited. Guys, Don Cheadle has also, of course, been on the series House of Lies. He's the lead. He's a part of the Oceans franchise. And he was in 2009's Hotel for Dogs.
Oh my lord, that's
more lighthearted than Hotel Rwanda.
In terms of the argument, we had an argument about Scarlet Witch and character awareness. Guardians of the Galaxy, completely unknown franchise, top five runner at the box office, so I don't know if that comes into play.
All right, good. Based on the arguments, I mean, sometimes you just got to give points for creativity. Hal gets the point.
Really?
It's put some points on the board.
I think he did.
Presentation is what won that
you
one.
Gave me, he gave a little. Exactly. He gave a little bit more. Black Widow was the obvious answer, as you said, and then I think you're.
Well, he said that, not the judge.
I'm just saying it all tabulated to Hal standing out.
If you want to go for style over substance, then you're
sometimes
right.
Sometimes
we are in Hollywood. After
all, I mean, you're still in it.
Hey,
so
I'll take what I can get.
You're both vying for the point here. Whoever, if one of you gets the point, you move into the finals for our speed round. Kevin, you're already in, so you can win, get an extra point here.
What do they call that in sports when it's like you're a lock or
watch
some
sports?
Me neither. Somebody sports where they're like
Kevin just wants to spike the
seeded,
ball.
You're seeded.
Yeah.
You got a seed all over.
First round bye. Yeah.
Bye week. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
All right.
Bye seed.
sounds
even hotter. Bye bear seed. Starting
dirty
me and Andy.
The bears. The bear community is going nuts.
Oh yeah.
Roar.
Julian. We know.
Oh yeah. That's gonna be someone's. That's someone's screensaver right there.
Somebody's slowly going home.
Pitch us your own ultimate team. So we're gonna do something silly. Something silly here. I want you guys to pitch your ultimate team of any 4 to 5, five-ish characters that could take out an Avengers team. We did this one. I did Batman, Superman. You had to pitch a Trinity. I want to do it again. Tell me a team. It could be any characters. You can mix up anybody you want from any movies, et cetera, et cetera. Up to five. We're starting with you, Zach. Who do you pick?
I am picking the Keanu Reeves All-Stars. John Wick.
Whoa. Nice.
Neo.
Oh, my God. He's going to win.
Johnny Utah.
Oh, Lord.
Theodore Ted Logan. Those motherfuckers are taking out the Avengers. Hell, Wick can probably do it by himself. Oh, by the way, and when they go to jail afterwards, John Milton from The Devil's Advocate defends them all and gets them sprung. Boom.
Good luck, guys. That's
you know what?
Good.
You know what John Milton's going to be doing? Arranging their last will and testaments. That's a fun gimmick, but they'll get slaughtered by the Avengers.
All right, we'll come back and you'll defend why that's not true. Go ahead, Hal. You're next.
I've got a rogue team of badasses.
I think we have a picture for you as well. I hope. Here we go.
You had four. You had four Keanu Reeves. I got two Sir Ian McKellen's, Magneto, Gandalf. Oh, they're leading the way. Or Fassbender. Okay, fuck it. One Ian McKellen.
What else you got up there?
Jason Voorhees.
McKellen adjunct, I would call that.
Juggernaut. And motherfucking Batman.
Bitch. Wow.
Yeah. They will take on any crew.
Except
there is not a team in the galaxy that could thwart that.
All right, sorry. Jason, Batman, Magneto, Gandalf, and who was the fifth?
Juggernaut.
One of the Care Bears, I believe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's hear who Kevin has, and then we'll fight and who wins.
Okay, I am going. I didn't think to go witty. Trying to win, so basically
still can.
I call my movie Avengers: War of the Gods, and basically it is the Avengers trying to protect and defend Thor from, wait for it, St. Michael the Archangel and the Heavenly Host. That's right. Look at that picture. Come on, dude. You can't beat an angel. And I ain't talking about no X-Men angel who's got some mutant powers. This is God's fucking right hand. He's going to strike you down, man. So the only one he could possibly fight is the Thor. Mjolnir's hammer, Mjolnir itself up against the sword of God. Come on. Who doesn't want to see that? Maybe Jesus plays a role or something like that.
We already saw the Michael movie starring John Travolta.
This
no
is,
bueno.
This is better.
No bueno.
This is better. This is Mike. This is how we reclaim. You could easily say, we already saw the Captain America movie on TV, no bueno. This is us reclaiming Michael the Archangel, okay, brother. Away from that silly movie. Put a fucking sword in his hand. He's striking bitches down.
Is he going to dance in a dive bar again?
Why does Hal have to be
I'm
that
sorry.
Way?
I'm sorry.
It has nothing to do with that movie, Hal. Nothing whatsoever.
Is he going to wear
Hal
that
Evans
out of...
movie doesn't come to play in this,
is
man.
He going to have long hair and a trench coat?
Michael the Archangel.
You're putting his butt in that.
You are.
He
invoke the infernal
power. He was dressed like Silent Bob. He was dressed like Silent Bob in that movie.
A little bit. St. Michael the Archangel, dude, with a sword, striking down, number one, Hal. Number two, Hawkeye. All the useless Avengers, one by one, until it's just Tim versus Thor, man. Like, come on. God involved? And then you bring in, well, I can't bring in, well, you know, that's good enough.
You can bring one in. You're pitching. You go, hurry up.
I bring the Watcher in from Marvel. Because ultimately, God and the Watcher have to go at it. Not sexually. That sounded dirty. I don't want angry Christians again. That happened once in my career. I mean, like, the fight, the end-all fights, where they're like, oh!
All right. How is Team Keanu taking out the Avengers more than
By the
this?
Way, the Watcher doesn't want to fight because he's like, I'd just like to watch.
I'm sorry. If John Wick alone is the one who, I quote, you send to kill the fucking boogeyman... I think the Avengers aren't going to stand much of a chance, especially when he's teamed with someone who can alter the nature of reality itself and bend it to
so
his will.
So the Avengers are in the Matrix.
What's that?
Because outside of the Matrix, he's useless.
Yeah, but he shut down those things even outside of the Matrix.
And then died outside the Matrix. In that
I didn't see the third one. here's the thing. You send John Wick to kill the boogeyman as a figure of speech. He's a mortal man. The Hulk will pop his head off like a Pez dispenser.
Tony Stark would hit him with a repulsar, right? Yeah. From far away.
Man, did you see that movie? That dude was headshot.
Yes. If you want to kill someone who kills a dog, you get John Wick. If you want to kill a Hulk, man, you got to get an angel of the Lord, for heaven's sakes.
Yeah, and he's going to get smashed by Thor.
That's part of the fun, man. It's like, will Thor take this angel out? Hammer on sword.
If you want to take out the Avengers, Magneto, he takes Thor's hammer. What's Thor going to do? Then Gandalf will
Magneto
send...
Magneto has never taken Thor's hammer in the history of comics. You can't give him a power he can't do.
Oh, but Ted can time travel, by the way.
Ted the bear that curses?
No, Theodore Ted Logan.
Oh, good point.
Theodore Ted Logan can time travel. So he can... No, he's not going to be able to, because George Carlin was in his movie, and he would not be on your side.
Look how excitable we've gotten. Look what you did.
George Carlin, may he rest in peace, he would take
movies.
Kevin's side, and he would not let the traveling phone booth
I'd have Rufus
be on your side.
Side.
Yes, but...
If anyone remembers that movie, Dogma.
Yes, absolutely, buddy Jesus. Batman would take out.
Batman has no peripheral vision.
He's not taking out anyone.
He's a ninja.
He's coming at him from this angle.
Especially in that suit that was in the picture.
All right, let me ask this.
Dude's
That's
a ninja. He would
Batman
take out
who's,
all the ground
who's
level
taking
vision.
Out the Hulk on your team?
Juggernaut.
Juggernaut.
Yep.
Has Juggernaut taken out the Hulk before?
Yeah, for drinks, and now he's going to put him in the grave. He's going to put him in a fucking dirt nap.
Can I tell you who's taking out the Hulk on my team?
Go ahead, and then you will be next.
You know who's taking out the Hulk on my team? The Heavenly Host can't do it, so they call one of their fallen. Lucifer takes on the Hulk. Come on, that's so metal, dude. Everybody in the audience right now, they're like, oh, that's an album cover. Fucking Hulk and Lucifer fighting.
Okay, he stole from Michael. Now he's stealing from Tenacious D and the Pick of Destiny.
Hal, I believe I'm stealing from the Bible, not Michael. The Bible existed long before Michael.
I can't even imagine. Can you, when we fact check, can we check the copyright dates of the Bible and Michael, the screenplay?
Michael is 96.
Is it Nora Ephron?
I'm saying the Bible is
right.
Year zero.
95 maybe? Yeah. It was after Face Off.
Jury's out.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Zach.
Who's taking out the Hulk? It's either going to be Neo, or if Neo can't get it done by himself, Theodore Ted Logan, who, you know, I think Rufus is off stage during this part, so he has the pseudo TARDIS phone booth, goes back in time and prevents the Hulk from being created in the first place.
That's a bogus journey.
Yeah, that requires intelligence to actually know to go back in time and stop the Hulk from happening. Like,
hey, they do.
How does he function without Ted? Plus,
without Bill.
Yeah. Oh, without Bill, yeah. He's all busy being wild stallions right now. He doesn't want to fight anybody. He makes love, not war. You want him to fight the greatest, comic book monster of all time, the Hulk? Oh, forget it.
He got out of hell. He escaped from hell.
That's actually a pretty good argument right there.
By playing Twister, the Hulk is going to tear Twister Matt in half. He's going to take that Twister spinner and fling it.
The Hulk is going to melt him in those purple pants.
You say right hand green? You're putting it on the Hulk and he's going to break your hand off.
Everybody knows the Hulk hates spinner games. He likes dice games.
He does.
Or Popple.
Hey, they took him out. They took out Death and Clue, and by the way, as well.
That's true. He's got
don't mess with Jason Voorhees. Here's the thing: Jason Voorhees if he gets a little bit of someone's blood in him, it transforms him. So if he got a knife or something that he uses, some like Hulk blood or some Captain America blood in him, and he becomes super unkillable Voorhees.
I want to cite precedence. Where is this place where if he gets other blood in him, he absorbs their super?
Look it up, Jason in space, right?
Jason 10?
Yeah.
Look it up.
My friend Lexa was in that. She had to fight Jason.
Yeah, I'm not saying it randomly.
She's a skinny little lady, and she took out Jason.
I wouldn't lie about Jason.
I need that cited, though. I need that to be cited.
Jason is sacred.
I know it's sacred. I don't doubt
you. All right, so you have last looks here. Batman, Magneto, Gandalf, Jason, Juggernaut. Why, from each of you, why is that not going to take out the Avengers?
Look at that lineup right there. Silly to say. This is
man.
This
I
is
want
a
that
child,
on a T-shirt.
A child's wank fantasy. That's not a movie, right?
Sure
there.
Sure is.
Aren't we all doing this for child's wank fantasies?
I'm doing this to win, bitch. That is the locker of a grade school boy right there.
Yes.
That's not a movie. That's a fantasy. And what's the other? Let me see the other team.
Let's see Team Keanu. We didn't even talk about Johnny Utah.
He's there for style, and like he gets really upset. He gets really upset and shoots in the air,
and manages to take out Falcon by accident while shooting straight into the air.
Utah, that movie,
I don't even have to take it apart. Team Silly, come on, man. There's only one winner in this round, ladies and gentlemen. Heaven and Hell combining to take on the Avengers.
All right, what do you guys do? Thoughts on against Kevin and Hell?
Well, they would never include God in the Avengers movies. They would never mention that.
I think they would.
No way.
I think they're getting there.
That would alienate the audience.
No way, man. A lot of Christians like those movies.
Yeah. I think Michael as a servant of the heavenly host wouldn't be fighting the Avengers in the first place because they're on the side of good.
No, in my plot, dude, it's War of the Gods. They are defending the Avengers are defending Thor because God in heaven is just like there can be only one. There's one God. I'm sorry, your time has ended.
Did you not see in the first Thor movie where we specifically established that they are not gods but super powerful aliens who were mistaken for gods by the ancient Norse?
I do remember a very clever line in that movie where he's like, magic, science, it's all the same to us. A very thin line.
Thank you, Arthur C. Clarke.
Perhaps there was some godhood in there, man. So I think you got to wear it. But I can't believe I'm arguing with the guy that wrote.
Joe.
I'm going to lose that
Hi.
One.
Hi.
You might. This is a Marshall McLuhan and...
you know nothing of my work.
Joe, can we get a copyright date on the Bible? Versus...
Well, Michael is from 96. It's got a 3 out of 4 from Roger Ebert. So not the complete joke you're making it out to be, Hal. That's a no small thing to sneeze at.
And also Joey Lauren Adams, her Chasing Amy follow-up.
Oh, wow.
Guys, it looks like Jason does a lot of blood-related jumping and Jason Goes to Hell. If someone like eats his blood, then he can jump into their body. I don't know. These movies are weird.
they definitely get silly.
Let's see here. If you're a Marvel Ultimate Universe fan, in Ultimates Volume 3, Number 5, Magneto lifts Thor's hammer. Caveat: this is also the volume where Scarlet Witch and Quicksilver are doing things, and so
But that, it has happened.
Yeah, but in the comics where
he was worthy.
Siblings did it with each other.
It meant in that moment he was worthy.
And if we can just throw it out, Bill and Ted's biggest motto is be excellent to each other, so the pacifist thing might have an effect on how they can fight the Avengers.
This one's tough. Ah, man. There was a lot of stuff going down in there.
You religious at all?
No. I'm not against religious.
Oh, really?
It's close on Twitter, too, boss.
Is it close? All right, you have to tell me. Sarah, what did you think of the arguments?
It's tough, like you said. It's between Kevin and Hal.
Not a Keanu fan. Go away, you non-Keanu fan.
Why'd you throw Keanu away?
She shit on Team Whoa.
How come you're discrediting Zach?
Oh. I just think it'd be kind of weird to have all the characters together with the same exact person, too.
She went logical.
She's going logical. See, I didn't go logical. I'm not throwing you out, Zach. I think you went creative.
By the way, Team Woe could also be a team of Joey Lawrence's.
That's true. That's the sequel.
It came down all three of you at a point, because I think you did have the locker art is impressive. I think there would be a fight there for sure. I think yours is a fight as well with the Archangel, but it wasn't as creative.
When show me one movie where superheroes have fought heaven and hell.
Gods of Egypt? I don't know.
That's not superheroes.
They pretend to be
they
superheroes.
They have to wear a cape and or a tapestry on their back.
But that's where I think they both... Does Marvel really want to go with the god stuff? It is a little jarring, so that helped against...
They're heading to Thanos, who is the Mad Titan, which technically is also a god.
What was... It's just like, I took yours as a joke answer, but then you did actually give me some points that surprised me. Zach, so that's where that happened. I love the fact that you pulled out the time travel and all that stuff as well. Ultimately, though, it did come down...
Sword versus hammer, sword versus hammer. Hammer of God versus the hammer of Thor. Come on, do it. You know you want to. You want to see Satan.
I gotta give it to Hal.
What the fuck? Seriously?
I gotta give it to Hal.
Oh my God, he's got the juggernaut on his team.
I think he gave, very close to Zach for your creative points, but I thought the Michael stuff was very funny and great to knock you out because it really got to push your buttons very well.
I hope to God you lost every Michael movie fan on the internet.
Very upset.
They're all turning their back on you right now.
And the fact that you were able to point that he lifted up the hammer and stuff, which was true, and some of the facts you brought, it did weigh you over. I was close to going with Zach. Actually, both of you were over Kevin.
Oh, I think I smell a little nepotism, folks.
Hal gets the last point.
Chunky's getting his chunky's back.
This was a really tough game. Everyone online, I'm sure, is hating me because I'm being in... I don't know, but I got to go with my gut. Hal got just a slight edge. Zach, though, wow. Zach, how about a round of applause for Zach Stenz? You are welcome back anytime, good sir.
Thank
you thank you for popping my movie fights,
I hope
Sherry.
You'll come back. Now you know how this works even more.
Anytime. You're both the noise and the funk.
You will have to help me, though, here with the speed round. You're going to help judge. So listen to their arguments. You're going to help determine the winner. Like on Survivor, you're now the jury.
Okay.
All right, here we go.
Guy
speed round.
I know a little bit. Guy I'm working with on another thing.
Separate
totally
it.
Neutral.
Right
separate
speed
it.
Force.
Totally neutral.
Team Speed Force.
You better separate it. It's about the
Kevin, I just want you to know
come
your
home
movie's...
Come home to me, Kevin. Come home to me.
Oh, shit, son. Remember that moment?
Kevin,
give us a wide. Give us a wide. Remember this?
Come home.
Your movie's
meant
to
come
shut up.
Home.
Okay.
And that's from The Flash. So
yeah,
you know
they were doing a Flash moment. Now
oh, gotcha. I just want to say your movies meant a lot to me growing up and coming of age, and I love them, and Clerks made me want to get into this stuff. But right now, that's all out the window, baby!
I feel you, and I want to tell you that I'm glad you said coming. It was hot.
All right, so Zach, this is speed round. They're going to be answering. Sarah.
One more time. How does this happen again?
So I'm going to tell you. You're going to help me.
Going to do the Carson thing.
You will. So I'm going to give you a topic, a question. You will have to answer quickly. First answer that comes out is what you get. If you both say the same thing at the same time, whoever said it first gets the answer. You'll have to pick another one. You'll have 20 seconds to argue, each of you, and then you'll have a 10-second rebuttal.
Okay.
So this is speed round. You don't know these questions. They're coming quick and fast. Are you guys ready?
God damn it. I could have won the last round if I'd said Avengers versus the Empire.
That would have been fun.
You know what I'm saying?
Done it. Shit, yeah, creative and fun. He brought some more creative, that heavy metal.
That'll show you, kids. Don't smoke weed before moving. Damn it.
All right, here we go.
Bargain bin. Lightsaber on Molinier? Come on.
I'm with you. That probably would have won.
It would have.
Bargain bin question comes in. We love when we get your bargain bin picks. You guys are at the store. Put two DVDs together and tell us which one should we buy. Here are two that are going to come up on the screen. They will be up on the screen. You're telling me which one we should buy. Here they come. Never Ending Story?
Goonies!
Or Goonies. I heard Hal first.
Well, just because you heard him first doesn't mean that he said it first. Let's go back to the tape.
That is Joe. Did you hear him first as well?
I did.
There we go.
Sorry. You guys are on the bag for fellow junkies. I know what this is about.
All right, we got Goonies versus Never Ending Story. So, you have a moment. Goonies is up first. 20 seconds on the clock, Joe.
20 seconds.
And go.
Goonies is one of the greatest childhood journeys and adventures of all times. Iconic classic villains with the Fratelli family. And Sloth, Chunk, oh my gosh. The contraptions that the one character has, the punching glove. There are so many great moments.
All right, Kevin, time starts when you start.
Never Ending Story, folks, is every boy's fantasy and girl's fantasy. We see Atreyu and his magic luck dragon. God, what was his name? What?
He was a luck dragon.
Falcor. Thank you, Falcor. I was going to say Falco, which was like Rock Me Amadeus, but that'd be wrong. This is a movie that doesn't live up to its title because it ends.
All right, 10-second rebuttal. You'll have time again. Go ahead, Dal.
That's a nice film. This is the definitive rollicking journey of children that you dream of becoming. You can go on these adventures in your backyard. There are so many wonderful moments and pieces.
10 seconds, Kevin, when you begin.
Soar on the back of a giant dog that looks like a dragon, kind of, man, and he talks to you. He's your buddy. Like, Goonies, man, you're hanging out with kids, don't even like you. You don't see the squid.
All right, based on the arguments, Zach, based on the arguments, where do you lead?
Based on the arguments, I lean a little bit towards Goonies.
Sarah?
I agree.
That's a 3
for
3.
You guys are fighting with your heart, not the argument. You're going, well, I like Goonies better.
You had some good points, though. At the end, you got a little bit more passionate. Yeah, you're back in this, I think.
Thank you.
Here we go. Well, 1 point for Hal. You were tied, so this is where we're keep going. Number two.
Are we looking at the screen again or no?
No. Now it's just inside.
Look inside our hearts.
Which DC Cinematic Universe character should cameo on the Flash TV show?
Aquaman.
Joker.
Oh, okay. Aquaman was first, that means you're up, Kevin, whenever you're ready. Go
King
ahead.
Of the Seven Seas, ladies and gentlemen. You've not really seen them do the ocean on the land in these TV shows or movies yet, as a matter of fact. So you're talking about flagship member of the Justice League, and it gives him a chance to take him out of that orange shirt and show him the powers that he has, the powers of almost a water-based god, more water on Earth than land. So this guy's hugely powerful, and the Flash can run on water.
Hal?
Joker makes everything better. I love the Joker. He's going to come in, he's going to save the DC cinematic universe, and it would be awesome to see him on the Flash raking havoc. The Joker he adds chaos and unpredictability. It would be so much fun, and he amps up everything he's a part of. The Joker was the best part of Batman.
Kevin, 10 seconds.
I've seen the Joker an awful lot, and I can't wait to see Jared Leto's performance of him, but let's see something new for a change. We haven't seen that much of Aquaman, and the idea of Aquaman hurling a shark at somebody to bite their head off to defend himself, or that's exciting.
Hal, 10 seconds.
So, the Joker in the Batman TV series, Tim Burton's Batman, and Dark Knight, he's the best part of every one of those movies. The Joker would come in and lift the series.
I gotta go to Zach first. As a Flash writer, what do you think? Who would you?
I want to see a shark get thrown at a bad guy. That's
thank you.
Just
Sarah.
I want to see that.
I agree again.
I agree as well.
We all
see?
Do. Stop using sharks.
Now
okay, as
see,
a
we're
weapon.
Tied. We're tied. Zach, who would you have picked?
Who would I have picked?
Who from the DCU would you have wanted to write a Flash episode with?
The
chance. Doom Patrol.
Yes, bitch, right there.
Wow, fun.
I was excited about that one. You can tell. Doom Patrol.
Yeah, Morrison Run.
Yeah.
Morrison Run's amazing.
Maybe, let's make it happen.
Robot Man. It's coming back. Gerard Way's doing it.
Here we go. Ready? Number
I
three.
Love that.
You're tied.
Okay. Are we looking at the screen or not?
Yes.
Oh.
No, no screen. Oh. At each other, okay. If you want. Let's stare at each other. There you go. Stare now. Best X-Men movie.
Days of Future Past.
X-Men 2.
Fuck,
you guys, no one
say.
Picked Zach's movie.
No one picked my movie.
It's okay.
If you had been chosen, would you have picked your own?
No, just because I would have I would have disqualified it.
So Days of Future Past for Kevin and X2 for Hal. All right, I heard Days of Future Past first, so that was you, Kevin. Go ahead.
Days of Future Past, of course, is based on comic book source material, one of the greatest stories, X-Men stories ever written. To see it come to the screen and watch the Sentinels finally come to life, which is our massive part of the X-Men lore. It was a very exciting time. They were able to play with time travel, which is always fun in a movie, and they did it particularly at the right time with this franchise when they've been a little deep in the long in the tooth.
Go ahead.
X-Men 2 opened the X-Men opened the door. X-Men 2 perfected it. It's absolutely the Empire or the Dark Knight of the X-Men franchise. The second film that one-upped. We saw the characters literally at the height of their powers. That was a good movie, but it was mostly as a reboot for the franchise. It was like a tactical film.
10 seconds.
A tactical film, but with Sentinels, man. There's really, you know, you got Nightcrawler in X2, and I love that opening sequence of that movie, but the rest of the movie is totally wonderful and one of the greatest comic book movies ever made. I put it in the top 20. But I would put Days of Future Past over in the top 20.
What we learn about Professor X and Magneto and their relationship and the way it's defined in that movie and the battles, it makes it the best X-Men movie. Bryan Singer's finest hour.
Whoo, Sarah, I'm going to you first this time. What do you think based on the arguments?
Oh, gosh. Based on the arguments, I have to say Hal.
Zach, based on the arguments.
Hal.
I'm with you. It's 3-for-3 on that one.
That was tough. I actually wanted to say X2 and said Days of Future Past instead.
Yeah.
I was ready to fight for X2.
I'm glad you spoke first because it gave me a second to like kind of...
I do. I saw him thinking and I was like, God, I hope he doesn't say 2 if he chooses 2. I was hoping he'd pick 3.
I love X2.
It's good.
I love X2. It's a wonderful movie.
I like First Class.
All
right, here we go. In honor of Jumanji, which franchise should The Rock join next? Because he's in Jumanji, guys. Any franchise.
I'm writing a movie for him right now.
I think it's foolish to go first.
You just have to, your time will run up.
Playing strategy.
Oh, I'll he has one.
I have an answer. I'm just waiting to go.
Wow, this is the first.
Okay.
Hal doesn't have one?
Oh, no.
I'm going to...
We're waiting on you both.
All right.
Oh, I'm waiting on both of you. I'm about to call 5 seconds.
That's fine. As soon as he speaks,
The Creed / Rocky franchise.
The Green Lantern franchise.
I knew you were going to have different answers. All right. That was such a broad... Rocky? Rocky versus Green Lantern. Okay. Rocky was first. Go ahead, Hal.
So I think we've seen The Rock is fantastic, but The Rock doesn't carry a film by himself. He's great as a tertiary character. Creed, he's going to need someone to go up against next. Wow, what about a villain turn for The Rock? How badass would that be? He would blow Clubber Lang, Mr. T, out of the water. I would love to see that. I'd slap down $15 to see that.
Ooh, Kevin, you're up.
I've already seen a wrestler fight a boxer in one of those Rocky movies when Thunder Lips climbed into the ring. So I don't need to see that. I don't want to see a third character get added to the Rocky franchise. I like that relationship. What am I doing here? I
forgot. Green Lantern.
Oh, Green Lantern. I forgot to talk about it. I thought I was going after.
You're out of time.
Fair enough.
He wouldn't be as a wrestler. He'd be a boxer, and he'd be the most devastating. Maybe he killed someone in the ring, and Creed has to go against him, and now he's scared to get killed in the ring like his father was. Oh, my gosh.
All right, now it starts when you begin, so you can take a second, 10 seconds. Why Green Lantern?
John Stewart, Green Lantern, with The Rock in that role. Dwayne The Rock Johnson as the John Stewart Green Lantern is the Green Lantern movie I think we've all been waiting for. A nation of kids grew up watching the Justice League cartoon. John Stewart is their Green Lantern. That man is their Green Lantern, John Stewart.
Zach, based on the arguments.
He had a stronger pick, but he made a better argument.
I agree. Sarah?
Yeah.
Wow, we're all unanimous on these. It's not over though,
sorry, Kevin.
What happened?
No, yeah, it's not. You got to get
a better
this.
Pick, but he had a better argument?
Yeah, Hal definitely had the better argument. So correct me if I'm wrong.
Go to the internet for that one.
Are we out of votes? Is that it?
Yeah.
Hal won?
Yeah.
Wow. Oh. Are we sure? 1, 2, 3. Yeah, I guess he got 3 points. He can't get the second.
An anticlimactic ending. Did he win?
He won.
Hal, you won!
Did I?
Man, too many
no,
Hal won!
I cannot!
Won what he's won!
Wow!
A Screen Junkie won on the Screen Junkie show. How weird.
Oh, you messed up that speed round.
I did. I should have said X2.
First of all, I cannot believe I that you say I won when I'm arguing against one of my heroes and someone who I love and adore. He was on the Screen Junkie show. I'm
my mind.
Hal, you did it. Hal, thank you all.
You wrapped the whole team very well.
Let's wrap this up. We'll be quickly on After the Fight. All right, after this, Kevin, at that Kevin Smith, please go subscribe to Kevin on YouTube. Smodcast. What else? Where else can people find?
I'm all over the
all
internet.
Over the place.
Can't get away from. I'm like herpes on the internet. Just won't go away.
We love you, sir. Thank you so much for being a good friend here. Come to the show and coming back. At that Kevin Smith on Twitter. Again, YouTube's Kevin Smith.
Technically, Zach, I won.
Zach, I'm sure they'll say that online. Zach Stentz at MuseZach on Twitter. Go follow him.
Excellent
name. Excellent name.
Anything else you'd like to mention or plug?
Let's see. I am going to be a consulting producer on The Flash for season 3.
Wow.
Keep watching The Flash season 2 and season 3. It's going to be a great show. We're already beginning to break stories for the third season. And in a couple years' time, I hope you'll all watch Booster Gold in movie theaters.
Yeah.
Love it. Hal Rudnick. Hal Rudnick, what do you got anything to denounce?
Yeah, I've got one pitch. What if Aquaman made an appearance and threw a shark at a guy's head?
Yes.
Yes. Think about it. I think that would be awesome on The Flash.
We all want to see it.
I do want to see that. Al Rudnick on Twitter.
Yes.
Joe Starr at JoeStarr187 on Twitter. Thank you so much, Joe. Good work up there.
Thank you, sir. Awesome being here. You on The Flash is such a good fit. That's amazing news. And Kevin, I spent most of my childhood trying to be Brody, so it's great being in a room with you. I'm honored, sir.
Thank you.
Sarah, how was that show? Sarah Tolley at Sarah Ann on Twitter. Did you have fun today?
I did. So much fun.
You got to see an all-star episode. Happy to have you. Thank you for helping. I'm Andy Signor on Twitter, Instagram, all that jazz. Please follow me there as well. And thank you to these people so much. Exciting as we more stuff coming. Comic-Con news dropping, so stay tuned on SC Plus, SJU, all our shows. Thanks for watching, everybody. Have
take
a great
a breath,
one.
Take a breath.
Bye-bye.
Screen Junkies, special victim.
Every podcast we put on YouTube comes with this kick-ass graphic, listing all the topics your favorite Screen Junkies podcasters are talking about. If you click the topics, you can skip around and choose your own podcast battle royale. Go ahead, try them all. If you haven't already, subscribe to Screen Junkies on YouTube to join us for future fights. Or if you prefer to listen on iTunes, click the logo to download an audio version.